So because it's under the network and Kinexus is a sponsor of the network, then there are like, hey, here's some ads. I think it'd be greatly appreciated. I don't know how far it's going to go because, like, not the network. I think it's going to go pretty good. But how many ads? Because he's still hunting down for sponsorship.
Right.
Sponsorship might include more ads, might have to parse them out one way or the other, and then going from there. How do you feel?
Feeling very good.
You ready?
I got to be better in social media, so do you want to do a... Okay. It's got, no, that's going to be... set a fucking video every guy. I am 80 years old, Carity.
Yeah.
I'm sure my grandmother could do a better picture.
Hey, man, I'm technically challenged, too.
Are you?
Oh, yeah, big time.
Oh, I'm the worst. Yeah.
This has been pieced together, as you can see, by, like, just a bunch of random stuff. That's my wife's old laptop, because my other one no longer is being supported by Windows, so that's how old that is.
Oh, wow. Yeah, good for you.
Yeah, so it's really going out
that's
there.
Good. Thank God for wives, eh?
You know what I mean?
They pick it up. Yeah, I do.
If I didn't, I'd be a wreck. I'd probably still be hanging out in this basement, let's be perfectly honest.
I like this basement.
It's not bad.
It's got a nice vibe to it.
It's a nice, yeah.
Feng shui.
Yeah, once I finally put up all those posters and stuff, it's made it a lot better.
Awesome.
The whole deal.
Good for you.
You know. Most of those I bought from when I was in my 1 year of university.
Me too. When they have those pop-ups or was it a pop-up? Yeah, man. I spent a lot of money. I shouldn't.
Those two, the Godfather one, the Scarface one, and the other Godfather one. And then I've got a Pulp Fiction one, but they're somewhere, like they're in that back room.
Back in there.
But they're the paper ones. Like these are the actual on print piece, like on wood and stuff. And then my friend Jimmy Cunos, who's an artist, did the Carnage and Venom.
Very nice.
And he's been on the show twice because we did the Avengers Infinity War and Endgame full breakdown, like 3 hours.
I listened to not all of it, but
it's
I
a
listened.
Lot.
It was a lot, though. It was very nice.
The Spider-Man one over here and the Captain America one over there. My wife got me one for Christmas and one for my birthday from Carolyn Harris, who is from Regina.
Get out of where is she? Where is she now?
She's still in Regina. Okay. And you could probably find her on Instagram.
She's a very
talented artist, and she's never done superhero stuff before, so. Like that was the Captain America one was the first one I got. I was super excited about.
I love the Spider-Man. That's my Spider-Man. So I love
it's dope, eh?
That's dope.
And to see that Spider-Man one up there, we got from Instagrammer in the States, and they do artwork like that. So he gifted us one to drop his name for the first year that we were doing it, which was really sweet. And then my brother got me the RE Gold one.
Very nice.
And that's the studio.
I like it.
It's a little bit of some posters.
Thank you for the tour.
You're welcome.
Very nice.
What's going on, everybody? It's G from the F-Board here to do another deep dive. And this week, this time, I guess deep dive number 11, I have Brandon Flegel.
Thank you.
This is going to be the second time where I'm a bit out of my depth. The first time was with your doppelganger, Greg.
Yes! We did a video together. We addressed it. People kept saying, dude, he looks a lot like you. I'm like, no one looks like me. We saw each other and went, ugh.
Right? Yeah.
I spit take. Don't.
No, that's fine. Yeah. That's fine. That's why the floor has got, old carpet. it's conducive for spit taking, right?
That's good. How did Greg do?
He did great.
Yeah, of course he did right.
That's why I'm out of my depth because you do this professionally. You talk for a living. Mm-hmm. And Greg, for when he was doing Justin and Greg and his other endeavors, he talks for a living.
Yeah,
so
he does quite well. Probably better than me, but we'll see how this goes.
We'll play it out, right? Goes. But for me, it's very daunting when I do that because the other deep dives I've done are with individuals that are of similar experience as myself. So it's a lot easier because, you know, I don't have to kind of maybe live up to the hype. You know what I mean?
I'll stop you right there. I'm a train wreck of a person. So we'll just.
That's great because now we're two train wrecks colliding.
Choo choo. Disaster.
Disaster. And so this week. Because we talked about this about a year ago,
we tried about almost a year ago,
And so now what we're going to be talking about today is, I think we're still doing it, Hollywood trends.
That's kind of
where you were wanting to be like, hey, I really want to talk about Hollywood trends. But before we get to that, a little bit of housekeeping. The F Word, as you know, is a part of the Saskatchewan Podcast Network. And the Saskatchewan Podcast Network has sponsors. And one sponsor, Kinexus. I'm going to have to read an ad.
Okay, that's okay.
Yeah.
I do this too. When I can't find my ad, I kind of draw it out.
Yeah.
Get lower.
So last time I did number one. Mm-hmm. This time I did number two. And then I'm going to try number three. Mm-hmm. I don't know how well number three is going to be because number two is pretty good.
Okay.
The Saskatchewan Podcast Network is supported by Kinexus. Kinexus Credit Union is all about their members. Improving their financial well-being drives everything they do. And not just something they say. It's a promise that's delivered by over 900 employees across Saskatchewan. Their employees are members too, and they've been there. So they're committed to making your money work for you. The banking industry needs to change, and Kinexus is changing it for everyone because Kinexus cares. Visit Kinexus.ca to learn more. That is, of course, another ad from Kinexus Arts.
Where did my pants go?
Kinexus Credit Union.
My pants actually just flew out of here. I don't know what happened. Have you done voice work? Have you been paid? This is a tangent. Have you? Okay.
I have. Not a lot. I stopped.
Right.
Last year, I did four or five of them. One of them was a big one for like $350 for 5 minutes of work, which was pretty awesome.
But, you got the voice, because I think I have a deep voice, and then I come here and it's like, you got nothing, kid. So,
well, I had to really sell it though.
Yeah, it's
there's
good.
A difference, right? And I've done some stuff for Ralco because my friend works there.
Okay.
And he's a salesman, so he got me on the Acura ad that's playing right now.
I knew it was you. I knew it was you. I don't listen to that station, but yeah.
Yeah. That's right.
Oh, can I do a plug first?
For sure you can.
Okay, hey, so I have a new time slot.
Tell me about you.
Okay.
Tell the fans about you before we get into our topic. Sorry, it's all about the network and Kinexus and shit. Of course, you know I'm G and Brandon. Yeah. Don't go anywhere. Mm. Tell me about you. Tell the fans about you, your experience with film, what you do during your day and what you do outside of your day.
I'm in the radio broadcasting industry. I celebrated my 10 years in February, and it's only really taken me to Estevan, Moose Jaw, and Regina. So not the big markets, but
sure.
I enjoy what I do. I love being on the radio. It's mostly country.
Yep.
Are you a country?
Unfortunately, I am not.
Oh, I'm glad. Okay. That was more dignified than fuck no, which I get a lot
Good
day to you, sir.
Gonna go for that, but no, I've softened my stance. I'm trying not to work with absolutes.
Okay, I like that.
Like absolute statements. I've done that many, many times in the past, and it kind of bites me in the ass. So
right. Would you give it a try?
I have given it a try. Okay. Yes. I actually dated somebody who was in a band that played a lot at the Pump,
right?
And she was a wonderful singer. The band was very good, but the music was really hard for me.
Yeah.
I was in it. Like I was in there when it was happening.
Oh,
so,
yeah.
You know,
good for you. Oh, I forgot about that. Yeah. That's right. Yeah. No. So I do enjoy, and I didn't enjoy, like you said, but it was, I try not to do absolutes either. I'm also a people pleaser. So I had a couple jobs lined up. They were all in country music. So I said, okay, I want to do this. So I ended up in a small town market, and ended up loving the music, loving the people in the music. That's the biggest thing about Canadian country music. I don't know. You could say about American country music too, opposed to pop and rock music. There's more of a family aspect. There's more of a communal aspect to it. So you get to know these people, these cats that are coming up, and you kind of have grow a relationship. And then I've actually blossomed with, I don't know if you know some of these, because these are niche country artist, but the Jess Moskalukes of the world. She's actually from Rokenville, mm-hmm. Langenberg. So she's actually a breakout artist in country music. So we got to know her. I get to meet Garth Brooks next week. We get to hang out, have a beer.
That's a big one. That's a big name. See,
that is.
And that's one of those things where who was I talking to about it? I'm not a fan of a lot of different types of music, but when a big band is like when it's been unanimously big, it's big, and it's big for a reason. You got to respect that,
right? So it's fun.
That's awesome.
No, I don't want to be a douche name dropper. But anyways, it was.
Hey man, it's real. It's not like you're dropping it for no reason. It's actually real.
Yeah. So
yeah, I'm hanging out with Jake Gyllenhaal next week.
Wouldn't that be great though?
Yeah.
God. Donnie Darko. What would you ask Jake Gyllenhaal? What would be the only if you had one question to ask Jake Gyllenhaal?
Yeah.
You get him in a room like this, and you only had a minute to ask him one question.
How pissed were you that you never got nominated for Nightcrawler and never won?
Right? Come on now.
Yeah, that's been my that is my favorite performance of his, and it is an absolute travesty he never got it. I would ask Toni Collette the same thing for not getting nominated for Hereditary.
For Hereditary.
Hereditary. Yeah.
I like to say
that one.
Hereditary.
The H one.
That's right. Yeah, yeah. Nightcrawler perplexes me. I get Hereditary maybe because it was a niche horror movie, but
sure.
I don't get that flub or the snub, so I don't get any. Anyways, so I enjoy what I do, and I love the big thing about it too is what we bring. People say that radio, like paper, is dying, but I find podcasts also have, like, so radio is an ever-changing market, and we can change with the time, so we can get in with the radio is terrestrial radio, but the ancillary market, which is, you know, Spotify and streaming and stuff, that also helps, ties in. And I feel that we also bring a local, immediate local connection to people who tune in. So you don't get that on XM or, you know, Spotify or YouTube. You get a little more of that. And I like to be, I'm from Regina, and this was the goal, to be back to, in Regina. So I like that I am a product of where I live, and I can give back to that community as well. So I'm in a happy spot. I've got the afternoon drive spot now on Pure Country 92.7 from 2 to 6. And I want you to tune in. And that has been my TED Talk. Thank you very much for coming in.
Your TED Talk on your life. Yeah, do they do TED Talks on people's lives?
So let's get into movies. Movies is my first passion.
Well, hold on. I know it is, but I want to know about Leroy and Leroy before we get into it. Because you do Leroy and Leroy.
I do that, as well.
So what is Leroy and Leroy? Like, I know what it is.
Right.
To an extent.
Right.
To a very on the surface extent. But I want to know what Leroy and Leroy is.
So Leroy and Leroy is a little chunk, a little look, little peephole into what a life in the prairies is like for us. I live in Moose Jaw, and that's where my partner that does Leroy and Leroy, who's also on the radio as well, we had this idea of, just because now I was moving away, I was coming, living in Regina, even though Moose is not that far away, somehow we could stay connected and you know, still goof off, because we would do this. We had morning shows in Moose Jaw, and we would do these characters, even though I'm silent and he's the mouthpiece and does all the talking. We wanted to stay connected. So this, in a way, was just kind of to be friends and have have something to do every, we kind of a lot every Tuesday night. We do these little vignettes, little skits, no more than 3 minutes long. It's kind of like Abbott and Costello, you know, the older, harken backs to the 20s and the 30s, Abbott and Costello's why am I blanking now? Three Stooges, stuff like that. So it's,
I'm a Three Stooges guy.
Three Stooges guy. To an extent, Silent Bob, Jane, Silent Bob, in a way where one guy is the mouthpiece, the other guy is kind of the mute innocent, and we just kind of showcase small town life in Moose Jaw and surrounding
areas. And you're the mute innocent?
And I'm the mute innocent.
That's weird.
Which is weird because I talk for a living. I'm a talker.
Yeah.
And Nick is kind of more of the laid back guy too in real life. So it's kind of like Jane, Silent Bob where... Kevin Smith notoriously is a talker, and he went very silent, and Jay was more of the, I don't know where I'd classify Jay. Jay's a different nugget. I don't, but anyways, in that way. So I chose not to speak when we were kind of workshopping Leroy and Leroy. We were both going to talk, but I thought I would go the opposite of that.
A little off character.
And physical comedy too. Even though this is not great stuff. This isn't like A+ stuff. This is two guys goofing around, but.
Hey, man.
We work. I like that. I like the goofy side of things. I like the physical comedy stuff. So we're workshopping that too. It's just a fun thing.
Nice.
When it gets brought up near my wife, she rolls her eyes. Her face gets red. She walks away. She's like, "Oh my god, that dumb thing that keeps you away from my children." So I can go and have a drink in the other room. So, okay, great, fine. That's great. Thanks, Brandon. So it's fun though. Thanks for bringing that up.
Of course, man. It's a thing you do.
Check it out. Yeah.
And you can find that on YouTube, or can you find that just on Facebook, or where can you find Leroy?
Yeah, actually, right now it has a life on Facebook. We've been trying to do more on YouTube, but right now it's kind of remotely on Facebook.
Just on Facebook, at Leroy and Leroy. Like, you just go and type in Leroy.
Yeah.
Nice, man.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, then let's get into it.
Yeah.
Your topic for this deep dive is Hollywood trends.
Yeah.
And I thought it was really funny that you messaged me today and asked me if I've seen Once Upon a Time in Hollywood.
Yes, sir. And?
I have.
You
and
have?
And I really enjoyed it. There's a lot of movie to take in. Have you seen it?
I have, yeah.
And what did you think?
I enjoyed the ever-loving shit out of it.
Nice.
Now, I was with a couple of people, and I knew a couple of people in the theater, and it was kind of a social experiment, too. Full disclosure, I spoil absolutely everything I go into. So I've already, I've read IDM, I've done the Wikipedia, IMDb. Mm-hmm. I've done deep dives on Reddit. So I know I hate being surprised. I can't control my life, but I can control my media, my viewing, my watching pleasure. So I spoiled Infinity War. I spoiled Endgame. I spoiled Homecoming. I spoiled Far From Home.
For yourself, of course.
Oh, I would never.
It wasn't an external thing. Let's put that on the record
right now.
Right.
No.
So yeah, the mob doesn't.
Those people
come out.
Are the worst. But for me, I need to know absolutely everything.
Yeah.
So I knew what this movie was about.
Right.
I knew the awesome twist ending.
Yep.
Or the alternative. Or spoilers. Sorry. I don't.
Yo,
I don't
yeah, this
know
is going to be spoilers. Spoiler yeah,
for,
yeah, yeah. Yeah. No. Go spoilers. Yeah. Well, I'll tell you why, because I'm releasing this in 2 weeks.
Okay.
The process of the deep dive
right.
is that I need your approval first, and your approval needs time. So I have to get it together, give it to you, and I let you sit on it and being like, I like this or I don't. You know Jim Demery mm-hmm. from Understand Us? Mm-hmm. Him and I recorded a mental health and movies thing, but as we were going along with it, we ended up doing like 2 hours.
Wow.
But we both decided it was a terrible 2 hours.
Really?
Yeah. So that's why I'm not shotgun releasing the deep dive.
Get out of here.
So we can do spoilers, because guess what? We're talking into the future
now.
We're talking 2 weeks.
Hi, future me. Please stop eating bad food.
Continue to eat. Dude, I eat a spoon of Nutella a day.
Every day.
I grab a spoon, I put it in the fucking jar, and the reason is because Soph doesn't eat Nutella, and I just eat it.
Now, is that why you like Nutella? Because your spouse doesn't like it,
no,
so you
I just
get all
love
of it?
I just love it. Okay. I do that act, though, because it's my own jar.
Gotcha. Gotcha.
And she lovingly buys me a jar of Nutella.
Oh, now that's why you put a ring on that.
Exactly.
I've noticed that I actually morph my tastes into stuff that my wife and kids hate. Because then when I do get it, it's all mine. And nobody will try to steal or eat it because they hate it.
Right.
So, yeah. Oh. It's another fun fact. So, anyways, back to Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. So, I knew what was going in, the atmosphere. So when I went in, it exceeded. And also I do that. I have my own preconceived thoughts, how it's going to go. And most of the time, even though I know plots, maybe I don't know, you know, everything about the movie. Most of the time it exceeds my expectations. And sometimes it doesn't. But this one did. Just the atmosphere, how he transported you to that time and place. Mm. And what I loved about it, I love hangout movies you just hang out with the characters and talk. And kind of really eat and drink in everything that they do. So like Jackie Brown, which is my favorite Quentin Tarantino movie, Jackie Brown.
It is, hey.
It's my favorite. I'll put that on the record. That's my favorite.
That's really funny because I was talking to a friend of mine about how underrated Jackie Brown is. My wife went to Denver for about a week to visit her brother.
Yeah.
And I watched it because it was on Netflix.
Right.
And I was like, I forgot that this movie
even
was
kind
a
of
good
existed,
movie.
Right? Because it came in the shadows of a Pulp Fiction, and it was his big, like, what
and,
are you
and
doing
Pulp
next?
Pulp Fiction is my favorite.
Right. Yes, absolutely.
I would say Pulp Fiction. Between Pulp Fiction and Reservoir Dogs, but those are the two. Like, and it's very clear, like, if you were to ask people, right? But,
clear cut. So going in, I absolutely loved it. So I was with a friend of mine, and they thought it was going to be a slam dunk. Like, it was... They're going in, you're expecting Pulp Fiction and Inglourious Bastards, right?
Right.
And this did not. It kind of fell under the radar for
this
person.
It's his most and least Tarantino movie ever.
Right. Yes.
That's the first thing I thought of when I walked out. Because Jackie Brown, I would find, is his least Tarantino movie, aside from the dialogue.
Right. Yes.
But in terms of structure of the actual story itself.
Again, hangout movie. You're not.
Hangout movie.
Most of those hangout movies don't have a central plot or a driving force.
Right.
So you're kind of stuck in that time, that bubble for 2.5 hours.
Yeah.
And then you kind of leave. Kind of, kind of like Dazed and Confused.
Oh, yeah.
Another classic hangout movie. Kind of like that, right? So I loved it. The person I was with tolerated it, liked probably the first and third of the movie, parts of the movie.
Okay.
The middle, even for me, kind of dragged a little bit.
For sure.
I don't think because of the hangout movie, I don't think he really had a direction. He kind of didn't know where he was going until that last beat, that third part of the third act of the movie.
Yeah.
And then I had somebody actually in my radio industry, you may know, I'm not going to say his name, but he actually got up in the second act and actually didn't, I don't think he meant to disrupt the movie, but he actually threw his hands up and said, I'm out, to his partner that he was with, and walked up the aisle. Or down the aisle and left. So we had a walkout, and we had a couple of drones and nobody clapped at the end, which I guess you don't really clap at. Well, maybe you do clap at Tarantino movies, but so it was weird. It was weird. And a lot of people,
he left halfway left through
the movie. some of us clapped. We're like, okay, buddy, there we go. That's it. All right, see you later. Don't let the door hit your ass out on the way out there. So yeah.
Wow.
So, yeah. Yeah. I've never been, actually the only other time somebody walked out and I was part of that was Bruno. With Sacha Baron Cohen.
Yeah, I can see that movie.
Yeah, but not a Tarantino flick. So
yeah, you'd think you just go there and absorb it, right? I know Soph had passed. She actually slept for 5 minutes, and it was during that second half part.
Okay. Yeah.
But she's a notorious sleeper. Like,
really?
Well, the second she gets on the couch, she's out. Wow. Movies not so much, but we don't go to movies often together because I usually go with the other guys on the show.
Right.
But she had a tough. She's like, I didn't love it. I didn't hate it. It's just in that middle ground. I was like, okay, okay. It's like, all right, that's fine. That's fine.
Does she hate the fact that does she hate that she falls asleep? Like she's kind of
we're trying to figure out if she has narcolepsy.
I was looking for that word.
Yeah. It's better than when she first thought. She's like, she's gonna hate me for saying this. She's like, I think I have necrophilia. I'm like, fuck, I hope not.
I was just gonna say that, and I was like, oh, check that. I don't want to sound like too much. Like,
she said that. I
hope not. Yeah.
come again.
Hopefully we don't live next to a
record
to a
scratch
graveyard.
Ear.
Yeah,
what?
We have to reassess this whole relationship.
Should have figured that shit out before we got the wedding. Shit was expensive.
If you knew that, yeah, that would have been a weird themed wedding too, actually.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, that'd be really fucked up. Like everyone's just got sleeping pills. All right, let's go to town.
It's my day.
It's a buffet.
So you enjoyed it though?
I did. Yeah,
so I enjoyed it, which is surprised you.
Yeah. By the end, I actually thought she was gonna hate it.
Right.
Because it, and for me, I was like, I liked it more the more I thought about it. It's one of those things. And I have to go see it again. I probably will see it again.
Yeah.
Because I think Hateful Eight is my least favorite of his movies.
Right. I'll give you that too. It's long. It's
well, and I think what happens is Tarantino has he overindulges, and nobody loves Tarantino more than Tarantino does, right?
Yes, absolutely.
So he overindulges a lot, and he really, if I were to take two scenes that would describe his the two different things I could say is the opening scene in Inglourious Basterds, perfect length, perfect pace. The bar scene, which is 33 and a half minutes or something like that, it's going too far.
It's too far. That's
you know,
right. Yeah.
A lot of scenes in Hateful Eight, most of them dragged on too far.
Right. Too. Yeah, you know? I totally understand.
This one did the same, and he played with his voiceover convention a little weirdly. Like it was nothing for a bit, and then all of a sudden, towards the end, is boom, 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 boom.
Yeah, it was
boom.
Kind of laziness. He's like, I don't know maybe how to get out of this, so I'm just going to lean hard on it.
Yeah, I felt it was more to assist the audience.
I guess. Yeah.
Like,
probably.
And that's me, to assist the audience to be like, okay, how is all this fitting together? Right. Like, how are we getting one? Like all these pieces now.
Right. To that. Yeah, that scene.
To that last scene. Right.
Do you like exposition dumps like that primarily, or not?
I do, and I don't. I guess. I'm starting to notice them more in a lot of older movies that I didn't notice.
Right.
I was actually watching Guardians of the Galaxy with Soph not too long ago. It was on cable because we're at my parents' house and we have no air conditioning, but this house has air conditioning. So we came on Saturday and just hung out here for the AC.
I love it.
And Guardians was on TV and I was like, there's a lot of exposition in here and there's a lot of exposition dumps in this movie, right? It was done interestingly through Rocket, right? But there was still a lot of them. So yeah, I'm not sure. I know Inglourious Basterds had a lot. And Samuel Jackson did the voiceover.
Right. Yeah, that's right. That's true. I guess if it's done right.
Which is a really weird phrase I've noticed. It's like, oh, it's done right. Well, what does right mean? And actually, I don't even know.
That's right. Yeah, I don't know. I guess it's atmosphere. It's how it's written. Again, that's
how
just run around and how it's like, delivered. I guess it's just running in circles.
Do you like do they bother you?
No, actually, no.
You're on board.
And yeah. And now that I consume, probably like you as well, I consume a lot of my media and movies and whatever, kind of half watching it.
Yeah.
I'm doing this with my phone a lot.
Yeah.
Probably trying to ruin the movie as well. So I need a little bit of an audio cue to kind of know. So that's not the way probably the filmmakers intended you to watch a movie. But and that's what I want to talk about. Trends now that we're going to see in in film, in TV? Where is that going to go with now how people consume their media, how they watch it, who they watch it with? Mm-hmm. It's going to be kind of interesting. I don't know. I really don't know. I was thinking about this. Where is this going? What are we going to see? I want to get your thoughts before I kind of dive into it.
The only thing I can think of is that things are changing, and that's what made the, and I mentioned on our live show, this is why I feel that the box office race now is it.
Right.
I don't think that there's going to be another film that will get to be competing for top box office.
You think this is it?
If Avengers never made it, yep. It would never make it. Really? Okay. The fact that it did, now it could live forever in that top spot because of the lack of people going to theaters for, I would say, at least 10 years now. There's been a steep decline.
Right.
There's issues going on overseas with the Hong Kong market and how much money was being divvied back to the States. So I know that there was a lot of, I don't know the extent of it, but I know there was a lot of stuff that they were going over there to crack some skulls, so to speak. Right.
Right.
So, and based on what you were saying on just the general way that people do consume music, movies and music, but all of that, there's less and less people going to the theater. So it's now in a transition point. It's at an inflection point right now where Avengers just got the win and it'll stay there forever because A, there's not going to be another thing like it, what it did and what it meant and how it built up and all that stuff. But B, people aren't going to be going for big things anymore.
Right.
Because I think the Hollywood system is trying to fight to get people to the theaters with something. That's why they're doing so many remakes.
Right. Yes.
Let's get our kids to see Lion King.
Yes. Yeah. The live action, which I think is ridiculous. And I listen to your, go back and listen to your latest one with, you did a review too on the Lion King. And mm-hmm. I was, because I do my drive from Moosh to Regina every day and I'm thrown on podcasts and yours is one of them. And I listen,
appreciate that.
Absolutely. It's fun. I like it. I actually kind of want to meet the guys. It sounds like they're a fun time. So the Lion King totally was it was all money. These are all money grabs.
Absolutely.
But I do.
Let's be real about the case that's what it is.
Yeah. And sometimes you get gold like the Jungle Book where actually it enhanced the story. It actually meant something. They actually put in a different angle, which was great. Mm-hmm. And I also agree with the technology, which, yes, it was nice. You can't. Connect with a lifeless, listless animal. So that move, that's what the Lion King lost me. There was no emotional punch. It was a beat, but it was a numbers, paint by numbers remake, and it wasn't as good. It was kind of like this when Gus Van Sant did the remake of Psycho. Remember 1998 Psycho? It was paint by numbers.
Exactly.
The only thing they did was add a little like creepy subplot about, it was bad. So that's what I hearken and I liken Lion King to that 98 Psycho remake. It's
that's
trash.
That's a great comparison.
Right. And it's going to make $1 billion probably in the next week. So
definitely. Yeah, well, stupid. But then how I'm trying to work on this. And there's a psychologist I listen to a lot and he always says like, you should really focus on writing. So right now I'm working on just writing, not to release, just to write shit down, to get my own thoughts in order.
Right.
Cause they're all over the place.
How tough is journaling? I know that.
Very tough. I did pretty good on my honeymoon. Cause one of my good friends, he's soap baptized both his daughters and he's like, hey, on our honeymoon, we had this journal and we wrote about every day. And so I thought it was going to be a hassle. I wrote in that fucking thing every day and not just wrote in it. Hey, this is what we did. They're full blown stories to where Soph's actually sitting because she's my biggest critic. She was sitting there reading it and laughing because I wrote things as they were happening.
Wow.
And I had titles and I had chapters and everything like that. Yeah.
You were away, though.
We were in Italy. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
So that could have been just, but I'm like, I'm sitting at the hotel at 11 o'clock at night writing in this goddamn journal, right? Like,
something?
And it was awesome. And now we'll have it till the end of
forever,
time. Right?
Yeah. That's great to have.
But why did the Jungle Book and the fake real animals have more of an impact than the Lion King? That's what I'm trying to figure out.
Well,
what
the Jungle
is the
Book
difference?
Resonated more?
Yeah. Like, why was the Jungle Book good? And why didn't the Lion King land?
Yeah.
And even just from the visual standpoint, what did Bagheera in Lion King have over Simba? Maybe it was Mowgli in the Jungle Book that was able to humanize it.
I think I was going to say the same. I'm thinking maybe I stole it from your mouth, but it was the kid's performance because you could bounce off the emotions. He was leading the charge in the emotions. and it was bouncing. So if the character had, 100%, it was.
We as the audience had a connecting point.
Has a connecting point, yeah. He was our entry in, and yes. So every time there was scenarios, the digitally, because they called it a live action. This was not live action. So the CG'd had a bouncing off point, and of course, yeah. So, yeah, and the kid was phenomenal, by the way, too. I don't know where.
Outstanding.
Yeah. So that's,
That was the only reason. That was the only thing I can think of, and I'm still writing it out, like just to process it in my head. And the other thing I came, the other thing I thought of was Aronofsky's White Swan or Black Swan, sorry. Right. So I was thinking it was a Black Swan, White Swan type of situation where what they gave us in this Lion King was the White Swan.
Right.
Everything was done to an extent correctly. Like everything, the beats were there. The dialogue, aside from some changes that I felt wasn't necessary, they did that. But it lacked all the heart, as I mentioned in that episode. And that's that Black Swan version of what it could have been.
Right.
Very much likening to the fact that, again, the Lion King was the B team of Disney while they were working on Pocahontas.
Yeah, yeah, that's isn't that an interesting fact?
I love that. That also adds to that film, right?
The underdog status of it.
Huge.
I think to add to your point, too, I think what Lion King gave audiences, the new audiences were fresh. So I don't know if they were thinking of the older audiences, maybe per se. You have to always, but they didn't add anything, and they cut some of the most important beats of the film.
Yep.
They cut most of the big song numbers, like the bad guy villain dump the song.
He literally just said, "My teeth and my ambitions are bare. Be prepared." And then the rest of it was like, that was it.
That was like the dopest part of the film.
It's amazing,
right?
There was a hyena's goose stepping. Right. Come on, man.
Or Jungle Book. Added layers to Mowgli's backstory.
Yep.
Leaned hella into all of the songs. They didn't flesh out. But again, Jungle Book. To be fair, Jungle Book wasn't one of the crown jewels of the studio. So you had liberties to take to it. You could cut songs or add songs to it. Where Lion King, especially, I think, to the people that are actually going to the films,
it's big.
Is, like you said, it's one of the big. It is.
It's my number one.
Yeah, it's the biggest 2D animated film of all time.
Yeah.
Gross, net gross, world gross, whatever. Yeah. So it had a lot, and it didn't. It just kind of said, look at us, look at our technology. And which all leaps and bounds are fine, but there was no emotion in the animation because they wanted to go photorealistic. That lost a lot for me, too. And you didn't have any human counterpoints to bounce off the emotion. That also, that connectivity was broken. So maybe I don't know. Was there a lot of kids in your screening?
There was quite a few.
Just a lot of joys.
They were relatively loud.
Okay.
There was some, mostly when Timon and Pumbaa came on. There wasn't anything else like that was too big in terms of a reaction. And it just like, and when I keep thinking about that office board meeting when Jon Favreau walks in and he's like, "Hey, I want to do The Lion King, and guess what? I got Beyonce."
Yeah.
Boom, all the money.
Oh yeah. Psh, yeah.
And she was fine in it.
Yep.
But I mean, this is that thing of like, you've got all these perfect like singers and stuff like that, but they just didn't give any credence to the voices. Like, it just seemed, especially with Childish Gambino, I felt he was very like, "I'm too cool for this. I'll sing my parts and then the dialogue I'll just say."
Right. Yeah.
Right. And it was I mean, it's my favorite Disney movie, so I'm obviously going to take it a little bit more personally than others. So that also plays into it. And that's another thing. Like, it was like a little mini subsection that I wrote in my little journal thing of just like, "Hey, you're also extremely biased. Like, let's consider this shit." Let's consider me yelling at you and being like, "You just love it because you love it." Right.
Right.
And then the other one, as I mentioned last week, was the fact that there was the four beats that always make me cry in the original. And that every time I was about to hit those beats, except for one, I think, it just stopped based on either a choice of dialogue that was said a different way. Right. Just something about it just automatically stopped. And I'm ready to like
go
fucking cry. Right.
Go. Like, yeah, it's go time.
It's happening. Right.
So that's interesting. I can't put my finger on it either, but we've both said it. So I don't know. Soul, I guess it just didn't have soul.
Maybe
it didn't have the soul that the Jungle Book had. Are you in favor? I guess you can't stop. Because you can't stop these moneymakers. Because I think, how many have they done now?
They did Cinderella, which I thought was pretty good. Beauty and the Beast, which I thought was good. Jungle Book, which is my top one out of all of them. Lion King. Mm-hmm. They're doing Mulan. Mm-hmm. I don't know which other ones they've done already.
Little Mermaid, have you?
They're working on Little Mermaid right now. Yeah.
Maleficent.
Oh, they did that one too. Yeah, that one was really good too.
Yeah, and that was doing actually the second really good one. Yeah.
But I mean, you had Angelina Jolie, so that's a big deal.
That's true. So, and all of these have probably grossed more than what? 500-600 million plus. So it's not going to slow down.
And they're not, and that's where everyone sits around and says, oh, they're not doing anything original. Well, first of all, I want to say define original.
Yeah, what is original? What is original?
I don't know. Once Upon a Time in Hollywood could be one. But it's based off certain events. Well,
I guess, but
it's still an original thing, right? And that's where, if you were to pick like for me, the 90s, the Tarantino upbringing, the David Fincher, mm-hmm. you know, and then before that, the Scorsese, Goodfellas, because Goodfellas is my favorite movie.
Is your favorite?
Time. Yeah.
What age did you stumble upon it, or maybe an older sibling or cousin showed you it in the basement when your parents were upstairs?
I think, I was the older sibling, but I think I came across it when I was like 13 or 14 years old. Relatively late comparison. Yeah. Same with The Godfather. They were all in one shot.
Really?
And my godbrother in Toronto, we had gone there for a summer, and he introduced me to Scarface. And I went a full month straight. Every single day after school, I watched Scarface.
Wow.
To the point where you can drop a single line. I don't know if I can still do it anymore, but you can drop a single line, and I was able to give you the first two lines before that and the two lines after.
Oh,
yeah, it was a little bit crazy.
Yeah, that's a great. So Al Pacino is the number one of all time?
No. I don't know if I have a number one. I haven't decided on actors yet.
Wow.
Okay. I would say Scorsese is my favorite director. Tarantino's number two. Right. And then there's a bunch of other ones, but I really love Fincher. Like, I just like his style a lot.
A lot, yeah.
And Fight Club was a big, big movie for me.
Yeah.
That was my transition movie to actually being like, oh, movies are not just visual things. Like, movies have meaning to them. There's stuff, there's subtext behind everything I'm seeing. Did you have a moment like that? Is there an era?
Of my age, I'm of the era 90s, of course, 90s.
Yeah.
70s and 90s, I think. Yeah, I was going to say extent, maybe the late 60s, but 70s and 90s, I think, had the most experimental, the shape that shapes what we watch now, what the movie and film industry is now. I think the 70s and 90s had a lot of, you could disagree, but it had a lot of the filmmakers and mm-hmm. the way things are filmed, how screenplays are written. Yeah, so I would say the 70s and 90s are the big one. I remember the first Tarantino film that I watched was, I got into it pretty late too. It was my first babysitting gig when I was 12 years old, and it was just down the street. And they were really strict on bedtime, so they would have to go to bed. I have to put these kids down at like, so I'd get there at 7. I'd have to put these kids down by 7:30, and the parents never got home until after 11 or midnight. So mm-hmm. I had the stretch of, they had a cool ass basement. They had a big, big TV that was on wheels for some reason. It was like a 40-inch. It wasn't that. At that time, it was huge. I didn't have that kind of TV. 50-inch, maybe.
Did it have the speakers on the side?
Yes, it did. It did. I was like, oh, my amazing. God, Mom. These people are on a different tier of living. And they had, at that time, I think Tarantino had 4 movies, and they had the Tarantino list of our movies on VHS. So every night, every time, it was a stretch there where I was there every night, and I started with True Romance, which is not a Tarantino directed, but
he wrote it,
right? Yeah. As a 12-year-old, scared the fuck out of me. Just the Gary Oldman's performance,
good though.
Oh yeah. My god, what was it? Was it the Jamaican? What's his name? What was his name?
I haven't seen it in years.
Oh my god. Anyways, that's required viewing if you're listening and haven't watched it yet. Unbelievable.
Yeah, that's almost the first one you should watch.
Right?
Like, you, if you're really wanting to get into it and be like, oh, this is what his writing style is going to be like, and then you move on from there.
Right. The movie Reservoir Dogs, the scene, interrogation scene with Mr. Black and the security guard, stuck in the middle, and just...
Mr. Blonde.
Mr. Blonde.
Yeah, there was no Mr. Blonde. Black, because they were all going to fight about Mr. Black.
Right, that's why. Right. Oh, my bad. Can we cut that and go back?
No, it's Blonde. It's
Yeah, that's right. Oh, darn, yeah. I got to go back and watch that.
Stuck in the Middle, man.
Stuck in the... Yeah, that's that scene, just the way it panned out and his use of music. Again, it was like, wow, man.
Especially when, like, I love that when he's walking out and then the music cuts out and he comes back in and it just
and it blares
comes in again. Like, it's such a great
the visual, the atmosphere, mm-hmm. That's when I thought, oh my God, what am I watching? Yeah. Yeah. And that was, I watched it in order. So, and then I saw Pulp Fiction and then I was like, well, this guy's the best director that's ever lived. Yeah. And then I watched Jackie Brown and then that was kind of a come down. I didn't like it as much when I first watched it. And then I came back to it. Now it's my favorite.
And now favorite. It's your favorite. Hey? Is there a reason why it's your favorite?
It's dialogue. I think he had some of Pulp Fiction. Pulp Fiction is probably one of the finest crafted screenplays ever written, I think. Mm-hmm. Sound pretentious. I fucking don't know what I'm talking about. But I think it is. And then, but Jackie Brown had more of a hangout. It wasn't multi-tiered. It didn't come back and double back on itself like Pulp Fiction did. It was a very straight day in the life mm-hmm. of this flight attendant and her life and all her kind of friends and people around her. And it was just the dialogue, the crisp of it.
Yeah.
I just loved it. I love the hangout. I love hangout movies. And that's why coming back to Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, why I think it's so lovely and original and a breath of fresh air. So
well, and those are the movies, right? And the hard part is now is how do you market those movies to a wide audience? The good thing is that they're cheaper to make.
Yes.
If you're not delving too much into CG and stuff, which obviously Once Upon a Time wouldn't need to that much.
Right.
But you need to get the people there. I remember we were talking a while ago on the fact that the era of the superstar is fading out.
It's gone. It pretty much, yeah.
You know?
That's right.
You can't just put a name on a marquee and expect people to run.
Anymore.
Right?
Yeah. It's due to these big event films, these big tempo pictures.
Yeah.
Yeah. It strives on the name brand or the nostalgia.
Or the nostalgia.
Yeah. No more.
Well, and the interesting thing that you mentioned about the 90s, because I know the 70s were obviously instrumental in shaping what led to the 90s. And obviously, because Tarantino, for the different styles and different time periods he's done his movies, he's stuck in the 70s.
Oh, he lives. Yeah, absolutely.
He loves the 70s. His intro, like every movie he has a 70s feel to it. So obviously that shaped him, which shaped everything else. But it's funny how he made a movie about the end of the 69 era. And he was instrumental in the end of the 80s era.
Right.
And introducing the independent film movement with him. And then along came Fincher and along came a bunch of other directors that led this pathway to drastically change what we know now.
Isn't that?
And it's super, it was something that I was just thinking about 2 days ago when I was just kind of like mentally preparing about Hollywood trends and stuff. And I'm just like, wait a minute. Once Upon a Time in Hollywood is literally that rotation.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
Like it's just...
Very self-indulgent of himself. But again...
Oh, he loves
himself.
Doesn't
he, though? Oh, I love when you said it because I was like, yeah, there's something... And that's exactly it. But he loves... Yeah, he loves sitting in his own stew. That's for sure.
Oh, yeah. And it's fun because it's you're watching a movie.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I would also say that this is his most respectful movie, like in terms of Once Upon a Time. And I know we're kind of using it as a crux for this, but the way that he handled... The Manson murders and Sharon Tate,
right?
I thought was not just myself, but her sister even thought it was beautifully executed. And I remember seeing that interview he did. I think it was at Cannes, where the person's like, "Oh, do you feel that you like she's unrepresented, like Margot
right.
Robbie?"
Kind of
a few lines or whatever, and he says, "I reject your hypothesis."
Right.
And if it wasn't for how they did Sharon Tate, like how Margot Robbie did her. First of all, that second act would have been droll. I thought her scene in the theater watching herself on screen
was magnificent.
Magical.
It was, wasn't it?
I thought she was such a great presence for the limited amount of dialogue she had. Her presence was amazing.
Right. I think that's why they got her, I think. I don't think there's, outside of Angelina Jolie, maybe, I don't think anyone has that.
It's really hard to figure that out. Yeah, but like, and just his execution and the way that he used her, I thought was really great.
Right.
Like, he never, and why I say it's respectful is that he never exploited her murder. They never went that far.
Right.
Yeah, they went as far as to have those three goons from the thing, or four goons, I guess. One was Uma Thurman's daughter.
No.
Yeah, so the one that left with the keys, that's Uma Thurman's daughter.
Get out of here.
The only reason I know that is because she's in Stranger Things season 3.
she looked familiar. I did not connect the dots. Yeah, isn't her, that something else?
Her and Ethan Hawke's kid.
Isn't that crazy? Sidebar. I'm watching The Boys. I text you. I said, are you watching Amazon Prime's The Boys?
I really have to.
I'm watching with Brittany last night, my wife. And our main character, our character that kind of brings us into the world is just this guy that loses his girlfriend to a soup, as they call them. And we were looking at this kid and going, oh my God, who the fuck is this guy? Because he looked like one actress. And then when he smiled, all of a sudden an actor came out. Another actor came out. We're like, who the hell is this? So we had to look him up. His name is Jack Quaid. He is the offspring of Meg Ryan and Jack and Dennis Quaid.
Oh.
And my Lord, when he doesn't smile, he's Meg. And when he smiles, Dennis like elbows his way in there. And it's like, it actually took us out for a while. And then you get used to the character.
It's like the DVD cover for Pink Floyd's The Wall.
Yeah, right. You're like, faces are opening up. Hey, Dad. And then that's mom again. It's crazy. Isn't that kind of cool? And again, it's cyclical. There's a lot of Hollywood's kind of, I don't know. Yeah, incestuous in a way where you
it likes
get
itself
the trends,
a lot too.
And then you get kind of the, it's very cool. It's very awesome.
So then with The Boys being, I guess going against the whole superhero thing. Same with The Watchmen, because The Watchmen, you know,
is a deconstruction of
that superhero world, right? And so The Boys, are you finding that this is kind of the only response that could happen in this day and age when really everything is superheroes?
You know, yes. Yeah, that's why I think when Watchmen came out in the comics in 85, it was perfect.
Right.
Because you had over 50 years of storytelling. And it was getting overcomplicated, and it was blah, 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 or campy, and then it was kind of going grim and gritty again. And so you could actually have these tropes and stereotypes to work with and deconstruct it. Where when The Watchmen came out in 2009, we were still less, you know, we're still under a decade of superhero films and didn't consume all of our lives. Now, in a way, I don't like to use it, but it's oversaturating.
Of course it is.
Would you agree?
Listen, I love them to death.
Yeah.
But I love
so
them,
much.
But there's a lot.
So much.
And now, that's why when I go see a movie like Once Upon a Time in Hollywood,
it's kind of like.
I still haven't seen Spider-Man. I love Spider-Man. He's my favorite.
You love Spider-Man.
But I haven't seen Spider-Man Far From Home yet.
Get out of here.
I haven't seen John Wick 3 yet.
Get out of here.
Yeah. But the second Once Upon a Time in Hollywood's out, like, I'm there.
And that's going to, I think, going to lead into our topic, or we're going to push on with our, where the trends are going. But I want to continue with The Boys. The Boys, yes, because we have now 20 years now of all consuming superhero genre movies and now TV. I don't know how you can keep up with all of this.
Yeah.
All of it. And I'm surprised I wouldn't even have watched this if it was just a straight on superhero show. I would not watch it because it is fresh and it's deconstructing and it's kind of telling, it's kind of looking at the genre going, well, that's kind of stupid, or how it would be like in real life, and they come get fresh ideas. That's why I watched it, because it had a different spin to it. So if it was just a straightforward, I'm out. And I'm glad I did, and I recommend it to everybody. Even if you're not a superhero lover, you'd like it a lot. I think you would. So,
Well, I think the TV part of it is really what's taken away also from the box office.
Right.
I was listening to Jordan Peterson give a lecture on why people are consuming intellectual content like a Joe Rogan for 3 hours, which I do, or a Sam Harris or a Peterson or someone. People, they're selling out 5,000 to 10,000 person arenas to people just wanting to hear intellectual conversation. And he was talking about how we have, first of all, the data doesn't show that TV ever made us stupid. In fact, it made a lot of people smarter that were locked in their rooms, let's say. That was the example he used. But the other thing he says, people are into long-form conversations.
Yeah.
That's what podcasts have proved.
Yes.
YouTube, everything's at a snap. He's like, I started putting out my lectures. I've listened to every single one of his lectures.
Really?
Every single one up until today. Like, I've gone on a tear for 3 weeks straight.
Unbelievable.
But I never knew. I haven't listened to music in my car in probably 6 or 7 months.
Isn't that something?
Because I listen to podcasts.
Yeah.
And most of them are ones because I'm now in a phase where I want to learn. Where I'm going with this is that we didn't even realize we wanted to binge 40 hours of TV.
Until it was
given to us.
Right.
And now, and not only that, but TV that's really compelling.
Right.
Like the stuff that was going on with TV, let's say up until Lost, for instance. Because I think Lost was a...
I would agree. It was kind of a jumping off.
It
was a watershed moment in a way of how it was presented. Yeah, I totally agree with you. It wasn't there yet, but it was our first glimpse.
Something's happening.
Right.
Yeah.
This is how TV can be consumed. And okay, yeah.
Exactly. Right. And now we're at that point where we're happy getting a series dropped on us and just sitting there for hours and hours watching it.
Yeah.
Instead of going to the movies.
Or will you watch TV... weekly, episodically? Apparently, will you wait a full 7 days?
I don't think I could anymore. We did that for Game of Thrones. And so every week we get together with my brother.
But that was
more of an event.
Event, yeah.
Right now, I don't think I could, but at the same time, I always remember myself, oh man, I remember when we were waiting for every week of Lost and we would sit there for hours.
Yeah.
And the only thing we talk about is what the hell's going to happen, which is what I hated the last season of Game of Thrones. But I love the fact that I was still able to call friends here, call my friends in Calgary, and sit there and talk Game of Thrones for a whole week. Even though I was pissed, we would just talk about how pissed we were, and then what's going to happen.
Right.
But now, obviously, the binging has taken it away.
Right. Yeah,
because you're just going to watch it all in one dump and then go.
Does it stay with you? Some stuff stay with you or no stuff stays with you
anymore? No, most of it stays with me because you're living with them. Don't you feel that you actually live with the characters?
Or you're just overloading yourself if you're moving on and binging so quickly.
I'm selective now.
Okay.
So for instance, when I was living here and I was doing YouTube reviews,
you're right.
I was watching everything under the sun and there's a lot of stuff that I forget that I watched.
Mm-hmm.
Until a friend of mine the other day, he's like, oh man, there was that Italian show you did a review on. I watched it the other day. It was really good. I'm like, the fuck is he talking about? And it's called Sabura and it's an amazing show.
Okay.
Such a good show. And then it's got an older brother show called Gamora. Both of those are very good. But I was watching a lot of foreign shows. And those actually have stuck with me more than some of the other content that I was watching.
Okay.
I'm currently watching season 3 of they've dubbed it on Netflix called Money Heist, but it's actually the original is La Casa de Papel. You're watching it too?
I watched the first 2 seasons.
It's great.
It's amazing. You're watching a movie. The cinematography is amazing.
And that's the other thing. It's so inviting because you're like, oh shit, I'm watching movie quality stuff on my screen. What the hell's going on here?
Yeah.
Another one is Dark. Dark is probably the best show on Netflix. It is outstanding. It is a German show and it's about time travel.
Wow.
And I can safely say that without spoiling anything because, man, the way they do it is...
Oh, it's very complicated? Well, anything with time travel.
It is extremely complicated. Okay.
Is it subbed or dubbed?
You could do either
one. You can either or?
I do the subtitles because I'll read the English because, I don't know, I could be a purist maybe. Maybe it's that part of me that's just like, no, I've got to watch it.
No, I kind of agree with you. Yeah.
I like getting the natural reactions from the people when they're saying them.
Right.
Because if something's off, it really bugs me.
It drives you crazy. It'll take me out too, absolutely.
So do you think that the way that you're now consuming it is a sign of how far, obviously not how far we can go because you can keep going farther.
Sure you can.
But how it's going to take away from, let's say, other things you've enjoyed and you almost have to shed the skin of your former movie going past or self to usher yourself into this new era of technology?
That's a good question. I don't think, there is nothing better than going, that community feeling, there's nothing better than going into a theater and having that, the sounds before, the smell of the popcorn, walking on a sticky floor, watching a movie, and then walking out and going to the car and talking to your friend. So I don't think, there will always be a need for the movie theater. So, and I think that will never die. I think it will take event movies. I think that's where we're going. It will be these big blockbuster event movies until we kind of get sick of it. And I think maybe there'll be a resurgence of maybe not indies, but more genre movies that will come. Maybe the Western might come back or something like that will bring us. We'll always be need to go to the theater, but I think there'll have to be something like that to bring us out of our home. So I do believe there would be kind of like that. So I don't know. It's kind of rambly, but yeah. What do you think?
Well, and I'm not sure because I'm finding myself just, I didn't go to some of these movies because it's a lot easier for me to stay at home. And it's very expensive.
It is.
It's expensive to go out, and we don't even have kids. So I can only imagine for you and Brittany with the two kids, like,
it's disgusting. Yeah, it's $100 flat
just to go out.
Yeah,
like that's nuts. Mm-hmm. And that's like movie tickets and popcorn and everything like that. Like, it's expensive. So I don't know how they're going to be able to do that. That's why things like Netflix for $9 a month is much easier.
Yeah, absolutely.
They tried doing a movie pass thing in the States, but apparently it didn't go very well.
Tell me about that.
Well, I don't know the full details. I just know people that are like, oh, movie pass has screwed me over again because I was supposed to get decent films, price films, and it didn't work or something like that. The thing was movie pass. And I didn't delve too much into it.
Right. What do you think about all the bells and whistles that they will throw? So again, the experience of going. So
yeah.
You'd have to, I would suspect, would you lean into that then? So like, so what do they call that now? The 4D experience? You've got...
Don't care for it.
You've got the smell. You've got the sounds. You've got the...
Yeah,
you don't care for that. That's not going to draw you out?
No, it doesn't draw me, nor does the D-Box. I haven't done the D-Box yet either. Okay. I like just... The only thing that draws me in is that the Southland Mall has recliner seats. That draws me in.
Old man G over there, yeah.
Dude, I sit there with my popcorn. I love it. When someone says,
already out. Yeah,
when
right.
someone
yeah,
says, let's go to the Galaxy, I'm like, it doesn't have recliners. That's a non-starter. Like, and that's how far I've taken it, where I love the recliner, where I'm all the way like laid out.
Right.
But I enjoy being comfortable. I don't know if that makes
sense. Do you enjoy the communal aspect that I was rambling, rambling talking
only,
about?
Only when you can choose your seats. I don't like having to look for my seats. So
that's part and parcel. Sorry to cut you off.
I know.
That's what I love. I love the scrounging, right. The looking, the all that. That's what's going to bring me out.
It is, hey?
Yeah.
See, I'm at a point where I enjoy my convenience. So I'm the problem, and I'm also the reason why millions of why they're trying to give you all this content in such different ways and ways that are going to be more convenient for you.
Right.
But I think that picking your seat, I don't care if I'm sitting next to two people that are 800 pounds, as long as I have my seat, right? And I have the seat with everybody else. I think there's certain little luxuries there. Like the recliner seat is a luxury that if they took it away, I'd be choked, but I'd still go to the movies. But for big events, and I know they're doing that more and often, right? You're gonna get your to pick your seat, because I mean you don't want to sit in the front. I did that for Blaze of Glory. It wasn't fun.
Oh no, yeah, that's the worst. I don't even know why they have those up there. I really
don't think they'd make the theaters in a way that there's no bad seat whatsoever. Like you'd think they'd get
they
to like
figure
I
this
understand
out by
that
now.
The real estate is really dumb because you're gonna like eat up two rows so everyone can look good. Or everyone can have a good seat to see the screen, but come on.
Yeah.
At least that, we sat one row behind the front.
Oh, Lord.
And that was okay. That was not bad.
Okay. But the ones, that's unnecessary. Figure it out. Get your shit together, theaters. Come on now. Get your shit together.
And then so for you now, you like the communal part of it for you.
Yeah.
That's where it happens. Like, all that craziness, that's where it is. It's like Vegas vacation. It's not about the fact that they went to Vegas. It's the vacation
part. It's the vacation, baby.
It's the car part. It's the fact that Russ is being a dickhead and all that shit. Like, that's the ride
the
that you want.
The of getting the kids in, getting everything all packed in and ready to go, doing the head count.
Sure.
And then going. And yes, that's... I am probably the minority in that, but I do enjoy. I enjoy that as well. That's part of my experience.
It's part of your experience. But how does Brittany feel about that?
She is no. She's a maniac.
She
does not care for that. She is the. I need it now, and I need it in the comfort of my own home. Mm-hmm. And I like to be as comfortable as shit.
That's
and
great.
If I'm not in the mood to be around people, then fuck that. So she is. I think she is the majority in that. But yeah. Yeah. So that brings me out. But again, to hold a crystal ball. The future is kind of grim for.
It's interesting. It's grim is one way to put it.
Yeah. And is that a bad thing?
Well, let's put it this way. In I would say about 69, as Once Upon a Time was showing us, the Westerns were on their way out. It wasn't until. What was the Clint Eastwood one that he directed himself? Not Good, Bad, and the Ugly. Not Dirty Harry.
Oh.
Unforgiven.
Oh, Unforgiven.
It wasn't until Unforgiven that kind of gave another resurgence, because that's a wonderful Western. I like Westerns, right?
Right.
But you get those genres. That was a trend that ended up on its way out. The Coen brothers kind of brought it back a little bit.
Right.
Tarantino brought it back a little bit
as well. Yeah.
Bone Tomahawk was another movie that kind of, tried to.
Not a lot of scenes throw me, but that scene with the cannibals and
oh
my lord.
Yeah.
Anyways, like, that still gives me. I'm eating chili the other day, and that actually came up. I was like, let's put that down for a little bit. And it's a little hot. Excuse me, honey. It wasn't your chili. I swear to God. Damn you, Kurt Russell. Yeah. No.
Get the hell out of here.
No. My God. Whew, I'm glad I didn't eat before this. Cause
I'm glad you didn't either.
Your carpets. Well, I guess it is.
It's kind of like an opaque brown.
Yeah, it is, yeah.
No, it's
I didn't have a lot to eat today.
Saturation's down on this thing.
That's true, yeah. Kind of blend in. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, yeah, it's, I don't know.
But, I mean, like, then the 80s came, and then it I'm finding that the best movies, the most well-received movies, even when you go from superhero movies, because that's the new trend right now.
Yeah.
In the 80s, it was that those Wall Street types. Breakfast Club is one of my top five favorite movies.
Yes, sir.
Love it.
Yeah. How would you button down how would you button up the 80s? What was that? Because the 70s it was not the neo-noir, but it was the very gritty, I don't know, historical, but it was the very, because you had a lot of the Godfathers, you had the,
yes,
I'm blanking a lot now, but yeah.
I felt they really,
Raging Bulls, Taxi Drivers.
Yeah.
So
well, I mean, if you were to put the 60s or a lot of those Westerns in the 50s and 60s and stuff as the spectacle, then the 70s came the character pieces.
Right. That's the 80s, was the very political, it was the very grim and gritty.
Right. And then the 80s. Brought up the spectacle to an extent. You had the campiness, and then you had your smaller, like you had your more impactful movies, like your Breakfast Club's, Pretty in Pink's. You had kind of your movies like a Wall Street or something like that. Mm-hmm. Then the 90s brought back the characters again,
right?
And I think, and when I look at the superhero wave, the ones that focused on character are the ones that ended up succeeding.
Yeah, that's right.
If they just focus on spectacle, it does nothing. If you can marry spectacle and you can marry the character, that's when people actually gravitate towards it. That's why, let's say, we'd gravitate towards a Mowgli that's, in wonder of all this stuff around him and is living in it versus a Lion King where it's just is.
Right.
Live action wise, because for some reason the cartoon just worked.
It worked.
And that's what
odds.
I don't get.
Well, yeah. 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 That's a little secret in the sauce. I don't know. Yeah.
But I think no matter what, as long as, and that's where No Country for Old Men, it is a character piece. Mm-hmm. It is about humans. It's about the human experience.
Right.
And the human experience is one of those things that universally will never die.
Yeah.
And if you're able to do it properly, then great. And again, properly. If you're able to do it in a way that ends up working for what you're trying to convey, then people are going to be on board for it. And that's where I see each of those eras changing how things worked, right?
So by that, what do we see now? Because TV can give us that long form storytelling narrative where it's all character. It's a slow burn. You can get that at the comfort of your home. What would take that now to get you to the theater?
The same thing the MCU did, but with something different. You need a connective tissue. So what the MCU did was take the TV format and just throw it in theaters. Now, it was all experimental.
Right.
Reportedly up until Thor the Dark World.
Right.
That's when it stopped being experimental and being like, okay, we now kind of know where we're going towards.
Right.
It would take something like that. So possibly Cameron's avatars might do that. It might be that connective tissue because you're wanting to see what's going to happen the next episode.
Right.
Where in this case, instead of waiting a week, you're waiting 2 years. So the season finale.
Right. Is
and then now you're waiting until
right,
the next season.
Your season starts up again.
Yeah.
Yeah. You? I think I agree. I totally agree with you for better or worse. I know we can bitch about the cash grabs, but I think that's where we're going now. It's got to be the big tent poles. It's got to be the series finale to get you to the theater.
Do you think that, well, first of all, I want your thoughts on the 80s then. Like, how would you look at the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, and the 2000s, let's say, does that like because when the Matrix came out,
that was another
game changing tempo moment.
Can we talk about 1999 for theaters? The 20th anniversary of 1999. I was 15, 14, 15, and that's when I really started going to the cinema, the theater. What a year. Fight Club. You had Blair Witch. You had The Sixth Sense.
Yep.
You had Matrix.
Yep.
Unbelievable. American Beauty, which shook me to the core. Now I can't watch. I can't watch anything with Kevin Spacey in it, especially when he's a creep. But
okay. Actually, we'll get that to a second.
Yeah, well,
would you take 99 or 94?
Ooh, because
Shawshank. You got Shawshank.
That,
and you got Pulp Fiction. Just those two alone. And you got The Lion King.
And I want to throw in Forrest Gump.
And you got Forrest Gump
even
in there.
Even though it doesn't stand.
I think people...
Did you say Dumb and Dumber?
No, I didn't say Dumb and Dumber. That's 94 too, hey? That's a big one.
That's a big year. Big year. Oh, that's a good one, G.
I think those two are some really powerful years.
Yeah.
94 and 99.
Yeah.
And Forrest Gump takes the one for 94, but...
Oh, no.
Shawshank or Pulp Fiction, one of those things.
It's Pulp Fiction.
And it's really hard because Shawshank to this day is still IMDb's number one
movie ever.
Right.
Yeah.
And Frank Darabont, funny story. I listened to this on a episode of the Cinephiles, which I stopped listening to them, but because of the one host kind of just irks me a little bit.
Right.
But Frank Darabont goes to the opening of Shawshank,
right.
Nobody's in the theater.
Get out of here.
That's how bad it was. Like, you know that it was a poorly received movie, but nobody was in the theater.
Oh, outrageous. It was poorly marketed, by the way.
It was the number one movie on home rental.
On home rental, yeah.
Because they bought it.
Word of mouth.
And the guy that owned Turner Classic Movies, Ted Turner?
Yeah, Ted Turner.
He just put it on repeat, that and Casablanca.
Right.
And just bombed it. Like, just let here it is, here it is, here it is, here it is. Here it is.
Remember TBS or Petrie that was on like every second night.
All the time.
All the time.
And I still.
I did not complain about
it. What's crazy about that? It doesn't get old. You just watch it.
It's one of those movies you can drop in. In The Green Mile, I find the same
Green
way.
Green Mile.
Another, I think it was Frank Darabont that.
Yeah, maybe. That was a beautiful movie. That was a hard movie.
It was really good.
But 99 is also a wonderful year. Mm-hmm. And 99 is a tough year to pick which ones. Because not only, like, The Matrix, you can look back and you can joke around and all that stuff. But it was a monumental milestone for film.
Mm-hmm.
There's no doubt about it.
No doubt about it. No doubt about it.
No duty booty.
When you first saw it, were you in love with it? Was it theaters or did you watch it?
No, I watched it at a friend's house.
No way.
Yeah, I was young. Because how old are you now?
I'm 34. So I was 14.
Yeah, so I'm 30.
I guess you were a little too young. It was one of my first, my first date movie was Space Jam. And then I didn't take a young lady until The Matrix. So I was on a good run for date movies. Baby.
Space Jam and
Space
The
Jam
Matrix.
And The Matrix. Yeah, absolutely.
I haven't seen Space Jam.
I think we made
forever.
Out after too because we were just, it was like, wow. I was like, that was our first time making out.
The
after.
Toon Squad did it. Like,
yeah,
that's
right.
Let's get it ready. Your
secret, from
Mike's
Bunny
secret
things,
sauce.
Buddy.
You had your own water bottle with your secret stuff in it. Like, hold on. I need to take some of this. It is on.
Woo!
Are we cool? Intense. Okay, great.
Yeah, that was good.
gotta play you off as a respectful,
that's
respectful
right.
human.
So I'm gonna put cards on the table. Just because I was of the age, mm-hmm. I would say 99. Just because if it was for me, for my memories and how tangible it was, and being in the theater and living all of it. And actually coming into my own and realizing what movies are and how they affect me,
mm-hmm.
I would say 99. I think 94 is better than 99, but I'm going to go with 99.
I would probably agree with you on 99 only because of the impact that Fight Club had on me.
Mm-hmm.
It was was there a movie for you that was like, oh, this is what film is?
Film is?
Like, there are movies and film, exact same thing by definition.
Yeah.
But film in the cultural zeitgeist is looked at differently. Like, Dumb and Dumber is a movie.
Yeah.
But Fight Club is a film.
It's a film.
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 You enunciate all of the words. Did you have that movie?
Did I have that movie?
I thought it was, for me, to sidetrack, sorry. Yeah. I thought it was also Fear and Loathing Las Vegas, but it was the first time I got high. Then I watched that movie. Not a good idea.
There we go. Yeah.
Yeah, it's not a good idea.
Not a good idea.
But yes, which was there Chris a movie Thompson. That was just like your... Here, Brandon, this is what film is.
And it's going to be like, really? That movie? That doesn't make any sense. Good Will Hunting.
Oh, what do you mean that doesn't make any sense? That makes all the sense in the world.
But it's not something like not on the apparatus of Fight Club when you're working on. But I get
no. Of course anyway, it does.
Yeah, I guess
that's
yeah.
a that is that is a great.
I don't know
movie
why I said that. I know
it
is. Well, it's not like I said Space Jam or anything like that. But
yeah, of course it is. Because yeah. when you oh man, that movie
wasn't that great. Isn't that great?
Still
great movie.
Actually, for 2 weeks, Soph and I kept putting it on before I went to bed.
Right, it's one of those movies, and that's
Soph's like Good Will Hunting. I'm like Good Will Hunting.
Hell yeah.
I don't even think we got past the part where he wrote on the chalkboard. We were passed out. So we kept
that's
playing
like
it every
there,
fucking time, man.
But it's one of those. Yep. Ours at home is Bad Boys. That's
Bad
our,
Boys. Bad
we're going
boys.
To sleep. Bad Boys. So yep. we turn on a Michael Bay film to go to sleep.
Yeah, yeah.
But
me and my old roommate would do that.
Right?
We would order that and watch and eat order Chinese food.
Memories, baby.
Bad Boys and Chinese food.
So my wife's such a contradiction because she'll fall asleep to Bad Boys or Transformers.
Sure.
But I'm on my phone quietly like this. And she's like, my God, Brandon, could you quiet it down? Put on Bad Boys so I could go to sleep.
Wow.
Bad Boys. And she'll fall asleep. Yeah. So like the little noises would like kill her. But you put on like this. Yeah.
That might be the maternal in her because she can
be,
like
right?
hear through walls if the kids are off.
I think so. So that's kind of like a wall of noise, a fan maybe in a way where.
Yeah.
It's,
yeah. Yeah.
It's a little, yeah. Maybe. Yeah.
It's probably a good
sorry,
thing.
Sorry, Brandon. I didn't mean to sue you on podcast form, but.
Yeah, but we.
I did it.
We yeah. Well, you I came across it. As a wonderful mother that can hear everything. So,
I love you.
I think the last time, you know, what's funny is I was thinking about today too. The last time I saw you was Ryan's wedding, and we were talking about our love for the film world
yeah.
that we both didn't know we each had.
I had no clue, and you, I yeah.
We were talking each other's language,
mm-hmm.
and then, yeah. Did your wife tell you I came in with the Avengers theme song at the wedding?
No.
That's how Soph and I walked in.
No.
Yeah.
No, you didn't.
Yeah. Oh the second God. It did the da-da-da-da-da, doors open, we're walking in. I was so excited. Yeah. I'm so happy that Soph agreed that to that too.
Well, she was like, fine, just whatever.
No, she actually got into it because I just kept playing it over and over again and just really, just really pushing it in there.
Love it.
Oh, and then
right
that
would never happen.
Yeah, I also started doing this thing where I would start it before I entered a room so she can understand the impact of the song.
I love it. It was like little bites of it. Like, okay,
yeah.
Here you go.
Yeah.
Here you go.
It's like, dun-dun.
Yeah.
I went to the bathroom.
Hulked it out for 5 minutes. Yeah.
Yeah. Good Will Hunting is a great one to to open yourself up
to. It was
to,
one
yeah,
of
that.
And it was funny because that was later in life too. That was I was writing an English paper for university that was due 5 hours from when I started. So mm-hmm. I was walking around parents' basement like, oh my God, like I'm procrastinator to the nth degree. And I was like, oh, I got to get this done. It was just on, I don't know what it was, human behavior in Shakespeare's later half of his sonnets and blah, 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 blah.
You only have 1,000 to pick from.
Yeah. And the two movies that I was like, I got to get it done. Maybe I'll just throw on the TV for a second. The first movie came on was Fargo. I've never seen Fargo.
So good.
Blew my mind. I said, oh my God, okay. I got to get going. Next on TBS. Good Will Hunting. Oh, I never saw that either. Two of my favorite movies of all time. I failed that class, but I ended up with two of my favorite movies of all time. So,
Have you seen the show?
Season the one Fargo. With Billy Bob Thornton.
Great.
I did not see the second season, which apparently is just as good, maybe even better.
Very good. The second season was very good. The third one is super disappointing.
Right.
Yeah, I don't know what it was about that second one, but we just couldn't get into it. Soph was super into it, and she's never seen the original movie.
Did you ever or have no, you?
She hasn't seen it yet.
Why not?
Yeah, we're getting on it.
Okay, please.
On it. But I remember Fargo was one. I saw Fargo later in life, so I was able to appreciate Fargo the second I saw it.
So, yeah. That's also another, those two films were like, oh,
yeah.
This.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is movie making.
Well, and it's, I think for me, the realization of it is when you can kind of read between the lines and understand what's under the surface.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? And you can start developing those layers. And the thing with Fight Club for me is now every single time I've seen it, specifically in the, you know, from when I first saw it when I was about 15 or so years old, 13, 14, whatever, to when I'm 30 and the characters in the movie are 30.
Yeah.
It is a totally different movie to me right now. Like it was the movie that made me decide to like, leave one of my, like the job that I left previously
really
because there's a point in there when you realize that you are not on the path you're supposed to be on for one way or another, and right. you will sabotage yourself,
right.
much like Durden was doing, right. to usher in a new version of yourself that may or may not be the version that you want. Right. And sometimes you have to realize
right.
it's not working for you.
Wow.
And all of a sudden I was just like, shit, I'm 30, they're 30. This connects to me in such a big way. Fuck yeah.
Unbelievable. Isn't yeah, that something? Great. The power of movies.
Power of movies, man.
So with I guess back to our theme of trends in Hollywood, are they going to lose that then?
Yeah.
It's pretty much all gone.
I think what's
you can have your Tarantino flicks yes. every once in a while, but it's not going to be
when it's supposedly he's done after 10.
Right.
Because right. Kill Bill counts as one. Oh, he is, isn't he? Right.
What is that next one? Is it still Shrouded? I heard that it was Star Trek, but is it something else or is it?
I hope it's not Star Trek. I'm pretty sure he'd be ending off on another.
Right. One of his own self-indulgent.
Something. Yeah. Something super Tarantino.
Mm-hmm. Kill Bill 3. Could we?
He was talking to Uma Thurman about it.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Do you think they will live on in, like, first of all, those movies will live on forever.
Yes, forever.
But the movies that now will come about, especially now that the Oscars are kind of adapting
mm-hmm.
to the market, so to speak, will it now be in quiet moments when you're looking at certain movies, the quieter movies, and just enjoying them with a small group of people?
Mm-hmm.
Is that what you, like, do you think that's what's kind of going to be going on?
What you're saying? What's the new as in?
I
trends?
Guess the new trend will be keep going with the big stuff,
right?
The rehashes, the this, the that, and just on this back road here, there's going to be a string of these wonderful little movies that are happening that are being done by people that on Netflix because the Netflix movies are great,
right? Yeah, they are. Yeah, most of them are.
Now Netflix has been losing quite a bit of money and subscribers. Because right. you got Amazon, you got Disney well, streaming, you got
Hulu. It's a platform
Hulu.
That's never, yeah, their trajectory is never, they're never going to last long.
Like, yeah.
It's bound to go down. It's yeah. bound to explode and yeah. they'll figure it out. But yeah.
But they'll have their originals and stuff. So then are you hopeful?
Absolutely. I think, well, it's art. Movie's art. And there's yeah. always going to be artists always striving to dig deeper into what filmmaking is digging deeper into here,
yeah.
like your journals. It's always introspective. So we're always going to have those movies, those back road movies where like a Fight Club or a Fargo or a, any of those movies. I think there'll always be a need for that. The movie going experience won't have that, but the streaming will always have that.
And then do you think the movie theaters will ever die? I know there will be a need for it, but right. just like you have those old school theaters
right.
that play older movies in some other cities or right. whatever, they'll be like, right. oh, here we're showing all these 50s movies and stuff right. like that.
Yeah,
will it end up being just something like that?
I think so. Yeah. Yeah.
Like it'll always be around, but it'll be on.
Kind of like the drive-through?
Yeah.
Drive-through movies?
Yeah, maybe.
I think it'll have a niche. Yeah, I think so. I don't know. Will it ever die? I'm hopeful. I don't think
maybe not in our lifetime.
Not in our lifetime. I don't think. No.
Yeah. It depends how fast technology is going to move with it, because if the drive-through is still like you still have drive-through as a novelty.
It's a novelty, nostalgia. So yeah. I don't. Yeah.
But how profitable it is will always depend on the studio system,
right?
Because look at what happened to the music era, right?
Right.
Once Spotify came in, and there's a great interview on Freakonomics Radio with Stephen Dubner and one of the creators of Spotify. They were talking about how Spotify came to fruition.
Excuse me.
And how now they're looking at, now that some of the studios, the big studios or corporations or whatever, are now going to them to try to work out the deals that they weren't wanting to have before. Because they're noticing that, like, everyone's going towards this, yeah. right? And an individual artist is able to produce. Now, a 3-minute song, 4-minute song versus a 2-hour movie,
right.
it's a very different thing.
Absolutely.
Especially when you're dealing with distribution.
Right.
So, yeah. do you think there's going to be a Spotify for film that's going to supersede a Netflix and a Hulu and a Disney streaming and stuff, and that will end up allowing creators of all types to just produce their stuff on there?
Wow. Yes. I believe there's technology for it, and there's a way to keep costs down. I don't know how expensive that would be, but
yeah.
I bet you anything. It's the bottom dollar. If it's going to be cheaper, it's going to happen. And the need for it to be instantaneously, I think, I don't know how that would work out, but I think that would be something coming down the pike. That's unbelievable. I never thought of it that way.
Well, is it gonna take out the studio system then?
How bad is the music industry right now?
Well, I know a lot of the big four are they're all struggling because of the way people are consuming content.
Right.
Albums are now 6 songs long.
Right. Even the album is dying. It's more of a single. Yeah, it's single.
Individual singles can consume right away and then move on to the next one.
Right.
There are the way that the music's coming out now for me. I'm a big hip hop guy. I really like it. I don't like much of what's been coming out recently.
Mm.
But I remember when those albums would come out, like Kanye's Late Registration, and I would sit there and build memories around that album.
Get out of here. Yeah.
You can't do that anymore because the next thing is coming right away.
Right.
So then, much like you were saying with the overload of TV, are you able to establish those memories? You are no longer sitting and waiting to talk to your friends every week about what's going to happen next episode.
Right. Because
you've already seen it.
Yeah. You're streets ahead, if you will.
Yeah. And then, much like that music industry where it's not waiting for the album to come out. I remember being in line to get the Thrice album, Ambulance.
Oh my God. Such a great album. Did we just become best friends? Yeah.
Yes, that was
unbelievable. I love that album. My brother still,
such a
he
great
stole
album.
It from me and he still listens to it every day.
Their newest one that came out, I would say about 5-6 years ago, was pretty decent too.
Okay.
Very, very older
of,
Thrice.
Of, okay. Yeah.
Like it's a very
lost
different
their way.
Thrice. Yeah.
Well, they didn't lose their way, but they tried.
But this one's the kind of that's the one from that album is or the most recent album is the Thrice that kind of was like, listen, we were young and we were fighting a system back then, but now we're older, we have kids, and we have another fight.
Right.
And it's a very personal, and I really enjoyed it.
Wow.
But anyways, I remember waiting for that album to come out,
right,
and then opening the thing up, and everybody waiting for it, and that's the only way you can hear it, right? So as music. The technology of music has actually evolved faster than the movies and TVs and stuff.
Well, because music is cheaper to produce.
And
the turnaround's a lot faster.
So then would you then say, based on kind of the stuff that I've laid out, that you can almost see the movie industry going in the way that the music industry has gone?
For better or for worse. I don't know because music is kind of a singular, or there's one take on it. Well, the movie making process is such a bigger deal.
Mm-hmm.
There's so many hands in the pot, or so to speak. That's a thing. I don't know. I think it's too, especially if you're producing these $300 million movies.
Jesus,
I don't think you can turn around something like that that you could instantaneously put in. I think that's where it's going. And I think, I don't know, maybe, but maybe not in our lifetime.
Well, and what you meant said was a good point. The logistics of how much money is being invested. They can't do it.
No, it's a different beast than music.
And but, I think that one of the trends that has failed artists is the advent of, or not the advent, but the overusage of CGI.
Right. Right.
You don't have too many directors playing around with practical effects and being creative that way, because that's much cheaper than CGI until CGI gets to a point where it is really cheap.
Right. Well, it's becoming that where they're figuring it out. They have everything in place that it is maybe not. Well, it's cheaper to do stuff. Well, I don't know. I don't even know.
I don't know the numbers. So I don't know the numbers.
Yeah. I don't know, but it's getting there. But I think, no, it's not going to be as fast as the music industry is. I think there will always be a need. Oh, it's just the machine is too big to have it that instantaneously. Mm-hmm.
And it could be the way of the record player, a novelty,
right,
in and of itself.
When did that come back?
I never
got rid of mine. So
yeah.
I just inherited it from my family. So I didn't know. That's how I listen to my music too. So
for me, it would have been 2010 /11, because my roommate had a record player, and then we would just go to a place called Sloth Records in Calgary.
Wow.
And it was one of those cool, like, you walk up the stairs and there's like, it's lined with posters, like paper posters.
So cool,
like super
man.
Grungy and so like cool. Spray paint everything, and then you go up and it's like a legit
awesome.
Really cool record store.
Awesome.
That's where it started for me. But so, you kept going with it, hey?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, there's something about that. Again, our generation, I don't think there's, it's so embedded into us. I don't think the movie going theater experience will die. Will mm-hmm. die completely. So I
yeah, there'll be a group of, there'll be a group of us, let's say, right. of about, I would say, 50 years or whatever.
And our offspring. And
yours, the, because you're taking the
next,
them.
Yeah, and the
yeah.
next.
And the next one.
So. Might be that wave of the 70s and 90s directors that will bring these movies I'm going to show my kids. Maybe they'll bring that back. Yeah. We'll have one more resurgence, renaissance of those movies being made and consumed by moviegoers too. Maybe they'll be our one last hope. Maybe, I don't know, of how we view movies now. I don't know.
So. Yeah. And it'll be super interesting because when Tarantino came out with Hateful Eight, he had his super, like he was going on that big tour with the 35mm and all that stuff. And no one gave a shit.
No one gave a shit.
He had the break in between too, like the old road.
Yes,
thing.
Yep, yep.
He's like, oh, I'm doing this super authentic. And he just pretty much found out that no one cares.
Right.
And there's a lot of that authentic stuff that
might not come
like
across.
That, he loves it to hell, but nobody cares.
Nobody gives a shit. Yeah.
It's really,
right.
And it's hard to do that. Right. And right. you'll have the occasional people doing that, but I don't know how much care is going to be, at least to sustain it.
Right.
It's a great one-off, but mm-hmm. who knows?
Do you, I guess now that we're in an arms race of streaming, how we stream movies and streaming, what am I looking for? Companies, Netflix, Amazon Prime. Mm. What else is there?
Hulu.
Disney streaming.
There's a few others. Crave.
Right. I know.
HBO Max.
Oh my God. So
HBO
we're up
Max,
against a lot. Yeah.
NBC is tied in with HBO Max and they're the ones taking Friends and The
away
Office
from
Netflix.
Which
yeah.
is, yeah.
Super.
I impressive. Love how people got upset about that.
Well, I love how much of a resurgence The Office has had because of Netflix.
Like, right.
It is a darling. It's still the number one show. I think it's the number one watched show on Netflix.
Really? Over Friends?
Over, yeah. Over
Isn't Friends. That something? Hey?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Wow.
I'm surprised they haven't thrown Seinfeld on there. I would watch the shit out of Seinfeld.
The shit out of As I look into a nice poster of Kramer.
My Kramer poster.
I love it.
I only have one, two, three. I only have seasons 1 to 4 of the DVDs.
The best seasons, hot take?
Yeah.
Maybe not a hot take, but it's the
pretty
best
damn, pretty damn good.
Pretty damn close. Yeah. They're all good, but those are the hot ones. Sorry, where I was going to go with this, with those streaming companies. What is it? There isn't a lot of movies yet mm-hmm. on them. Like big blockbuster movies.
Right.
Yet.
Is Netflix there going is to the be? Only one that's, I think, going to be at least creating their own. So you've got The Irishman coming out, which is a big Scorsese movie. That's
right.
This year. Should be this year. Disney streaming, I'm not sure. It's all going to be Disney stuff. So the whole Avengers, the whole Marvel slate is going to be on there.
Right.
So that's automatically going to draw people to that. Plus all their Disney stuff and everything like that.
Right.
Hulu, I'm not sure. I know Hulu is also under Disney when Disney bought out Fox because Fox had an acquisition with Hulu.
You're
alone. HBO Max, HBO will always be around because HBO is its own beast.
Right,
I think it's got such a legacy behind it mm-hmm. that it'll always... It's like that pair of jeans that's just the best, right? Like you can go out and buy something, bedazzled, and walk around with it for a bit, but
right.
like
but
those are the
thin.
Jeans.
Right.
Like, they've been there forever and they're great.
And they're quality. Yeah.
Yeah. And
right.
I don't even
yeah.
think jeans is the best analogy. I'm probably going to like fall asleep tonight. I'm like, damn it, it wasn't jeans.
It wasn't jeans. It was sweatpants all along.
Sweatpants. Damn it.
I do like jeans. Actually, I'm wearing, they're a new hybrid of jean. They're kind of the
chinos,
the genos, or they're the stretchy. They look
oh,
like jeans,
yeah.
But they're very. Oh, they changed the game. Because I like the look of jeans,
yep.
but I don't like the. Well, you Depends get accustomed
the
to the feel, but the,
yeah.
This is the laid back jean.
Nice.
The how did you go with the geno?
I'm.
It is summertime though, so
yeah. But I never wear shorts. And the reason
Why?
Is, I don't know. I only have 3 pairs of shorts.
Word.
Mm.
Those calves, man. Have you been working out? Have you been cycling
hiding,
a bit?
No, I've just had them since I was a kid.
I've been blessed.
With
those
me and my brother
blessed.
Just have giant calves,
you
both of us. Yeah. We'll make Johnny Drama super jealous. That asshole's going around looking for calf implants. And I'm just looking down. I'm like, eat your heart out, Drama.
No, Scott required. But yeah, so I don't, it's tough to predict, but I don't think, I don't think people will stray away from the theater. The theater is just, there's something about it. There's something about going there that it won't be the numbers that, you know, you see 10 years ago. But I don't think it's kind of like radio. It's kind mm-hmm. of like where I don't think they can adapt. They will adapt as they're adapting now to the big tentpole movies, mm-hmm. the nostalgia factor they're leaning hard on, and those movies will help limp along, and then you can get your indie movies still. You can get your genre movies or your subgenre movies that will bring people out. I don't think it will die, not for a while, anyways.
Well, and I think we don't know what we want until we see it,
right.
That's the reality.
Right, that's right.
We have no idea what we want. Then we go see it and we're like, oh, I want that.
You're right.
And then the Hollywood system adapts to how the money's coming in.
Right.
So if they pulled out a James Bond movie, mm-hmm. hey, let's double down on James Bond.
Right.
And that's what they did for many years, right? Because people were going to see James Bond movies, mm-hmm. right? We have proven with our wallets that we are wanting to see superhero movies.
Right.
We've proven with our wallets hell, we'll want to see Avatar and these Lion King remakes because right. they're making money.
Right.
That's all it's saying.
Okay. What, if you were going to predict,
yeah.
What is the next big genre that will bring people out?
Oh, man. I don't know.
Or the flavor. Maybe not genre, but the flavor.
I think there's going to be I think there might be a noir type of feel to it. And the reason I'm saying that is because a lot of the TV shows now have a very almost 50s noir style to them. So Daredevil, for instance, The Watchmen is another one. It's got that neo-noir type of feel to it. And I think maybe that's more of a feel versus an entire overall genre, which that in and of itself is kind of a genre. But right. let's say Captain America never became cool until it became a political thriller.
Right.
A little bit darker, a little bit grittier, right? That's when people really transition to it. So that might be the thing. Right. I don't think westerns are going to be making a comeback. I think there'll be off like one offs here and there that are
Unforgiven or okay. Yeah, makes sense. Okay. Do you find that dark and grittier makes a better movie?
No. I don't think in and of itself it does. No. Mm. Do you?
No, not at all. Yeah. No, not at all. And I hate the fact, and that's where the superhero genre for a while got caught up in it's got to be dark and gritty to make it good. Mm-hmm. Not the fact if it has the heart, if it shows what humans are capable of or are flaws, that's mm-hmm. great too. But that doesn't have to mean dark and gritty. So
well, and I think people say aesthetic, but I don't think they mean aesthetic when they say dark and gritty.
I don't think they know. Yeah,
like I think they're looking at it as like, oh, it's got to be dark and gritty. So what? We're just turning down the brightness, like,
muting
is
down
that
the-
what it is, like.
Yeah,
the Dark Knight wasn't dark. Like it was dark and gritty, but right. it wasn't like they muted the volume. It was dark and gritty and based on tone and feel, not aesthetic.
Right.
And I think that's where a lot of people are like, oh, DC's more aesthetic and Marvel's more comical. It's like,
not really.
Well, aesthetically, sure.
Yeah, sure.
But not in terms of feel.
Right. Like that's right.
Just because, like I said, and I go back to Winter Soldier. That's my favorite MCU movie.
Is it?
I haven't thrown in the Avengers in there yet. But the Winter Soldier is my top one. And that one is bright in color,
right?
But it dark in theme and tone. So I was like, right. this is great. This is everything I want. And I think those thrillers are going to be a big one. And that's where that noir thing goes on. It's because we're in an era where people are really doubling down on the idea of injustices. I'm kind of worried. I'm worried with the Hollywood system that it's turning very PC. And I'm worried that mm-hmm. because a lot of celebrities are now going against that. So the very celebrities that were calling for a PC culture are now going against it because, hey, guess what? You guys are eating yourselves alive. Right. You guys are cannibalizing yourselves, right? Right. And that's the trend that I'm worried about the most. I'm worried about the trend that is going to affect, that's going to be affected by whatever political landscape is happening. I don't give a flying fuck who you vote for or whatever. Just don't fuck with my movies.
Right.
And I'm finding that they're screwing with the movies because of that to service some ideology. And I think anytime you service an ideology,
right.
you're off base.
Right.
Way off base.
That's right.
that's actually the trend that I'm seeing happening, and it's going to go across all genres, and that's the trend that I'm worried about the most.
Right. Yeah, I can see it coming, but yeah.
I could be overstating it.
You could be over in a way, because I think as kind of like a flu, there will be antibodies to come, a backlash that will come, and slowly will correct itself again. So hopefully we're just in the thick of it, and hopefully that will come out of it sooner than later, because I'm getting sick of that too. Not my movies.
Yeah, exactly.
It's art, it's free thought. That's right. So,
well, and that's the big thing is when you've got got organizations that are almost trying to compel your own speech. Mm. Speech comes from thought.
Right.
And if you want free thinkers, which you should be, that's free speaking. Right. And I think now, again, a lot of people and a lot of actors, actresses and stuff are now, like Scarlett Johansson was one that spoke against it. She's like, acting is an art form. This is my job. If I want to play a tree, I'll play a tree.
Play a tree. That's right. Yep.
You know,
yeah.
Like they're the ones that cast me. And the reason is this. Scarlett Johansson can actually bring people to the theater.
Yeah. She's one of the last draws. Yeah.
One of the last few. And a lot of it was because of the MCU movies. Mm-hmm. But then actress number 47 from audition number 185 won't bring in those box office numbers until she becomes a household name. That's why The Rock's in everything.
Right. Yeah.
He's like the last one. Him and Kevin Hart are like one of the last people, maybe Tom Cruise, right?
Yeah.
Are the last few people that can draw people in, right?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. That's absolutely true. Do you think, going back to Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, that was a draw, again, that was his biggest movie debut ever. And that was, I think, because of the celebrity draw. That was his biggest cast, I think.
Oh, yeah.
Of the moment
that you could actually see, like there's a lot of other people in it, but that's a big draw.
The big three, right? Yeah.
Well, you've got Brad Pitt and Leonardo DiCaprio and Margot Robbie. Like, come on.
Because at the time of Pulp Fiction, John Travolta was not shit. He was on his down. He was on the down.
Everyone was like, who the fuck is this?
Well, most of those movies, he had these repurposed the actors of old and brought them back and made them stars again. Where this had his big three. Yeah, so there's still usages of movie stars. There just isn't a lot anymore.
Yeah,
so.
Well, and again, it is an art form like anything else, and there's a vision that the director has.
Yeah,
and that's the way that they should be going, right? And that's another thing. I know us as fans, our trend is to bitch about everything that we don't like.
Right.
That's why when the Little Mermaid came out and they got the I keep forgetting her name. Haley Bailey.
Is it Haley Bailey? I
think so.
It was Haley for a bit, and I think it's Haley Bailey.
Yeah.
Which is amazing.
My response was, I just don't care.
Right.
I love the Little Mermaid.
Yes, but
I just don't care.
Fish. She was half fish.
Yeah.
Who cares what
I don't know
was.
If it's I don't know if it's because I'm just tired of that narrative anymore.
Right.
Like, and I'm just like, you guys are gonna do whatever the hell you want. My argument against it is always this: would at least this is something that I try to hold for myself, would the argument be the same if the roles were reversed? Right. Always. Right. We don't have to get into it, of course, but that's where I'm seeing where I just don't care, because I know if the roles were reversed, no one would be saying boo about it.
Right.
But they are. And unfortunately, that is a subtrend that I feel is seeping in. So that's why when stuff like that happens, that's like controversial casting, I just don't care anymore.
Right.
Like I'm not going to lose sleep over it.
No. And it benefits the movie.
I hope it benefits it.
Most times it does.
Yeah.
Most times I think they do it on purpose. Stunt casting in a way.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. It doesn't bother me. Just make a good fucking picture, please.
And I think that's another thing at the end of the day, just make a good picture.
Yeah. God.
You know, but I understand for the purists, it's like, no, like I want to see that, but in real life.
Right.
And I get that. Like when I was listening to Chiwetel Ejiofor's Scar, I was like, that's not fucking Scar. Jeremy Irons is Scar. Like, this is not right. And my brother's like, I can understand that there's another reason why they never even asked him to do it, but they asked James Earl Jones, who's Mufasa's only in it for like 20 minutes.
Yeah.
Scar is the big one.
He's the big one. Was it? Who was I listened to so many people. This bleeds in. Somebody said that it would have been better for Chiwetel to actually be Mufasa.
Oh, that was me.
Was that you?
That's what I was saying. I was like, if they were going to do a stunt cast of some kind,
yeah,
I think Chiwetel.
I was like, yes, he's got the timber. Oh, yeah, yeah, I think so.
Because I used the word timber.
Yeah,
but I was thinking because there was a lot of ways that he was saying certain things. I was like, that's very Mufasa-esque. Yeah, Mufasa. I could see you do that.
Yeah, I don't know why they brought back. I understand why they did, but why bring back an 80, almost a 90-year-old man? Like, give it to
And not bring, again, his counterpart, because those are too big. Because I think it changes the character.
It does.
That's the other thing, too. When you, the voice, especially when it comes to voiceover, things I've learned, it drastically changes the character. Mm-hmm. Inflections are extremely important because that's what people are paying attention to.
Right.
Because humans watching humans, we'll listen to it. We'll watch a lot of things. We'll watch your eyes. We'll watch your hair. We'll watch your nose. We'll watch your teeth. Whatever. The voice part
is the one. Yeah,
but we're not focusing. If you close your eyes, all you hear is the voice, and that's what you're focusing on the most. So in voiceover, like a car ad or something, you're focusing on the inflections of the voice.
Yeah, agreed. Yeah, 100%, yeah. That movie. Going back to that, I just don't get it.
Yeah, I don't get it either.
Piece of shit.
And they're just gonna keep going. Remakes.
That's right. Well, it's
because you're gonna go and take your kids and spend $100.
Yep. Yeah. Maybe not on that one.
No, but I mean, Mulan. Even though Mulan looks good,
Mulan looks great, and they're going in a different direction.
Some of those scenes look really good.
I just found out that they're not doing the musical parts of those.
Damn it!
It's live. Yeah, it's just a straightforward action flick.
Really want a Christina Aguilera to sing her song.
My reflection. What was the Disney? Going back to 99, I want to quiz you. What was the animated 99 Disney animated one?
It wasn't Hercules, was it?
No, that was 97.
Oh, wow. Was it Mulan? Fern Gully?
No, that was 92 and not Disney.
Damn, you're good at this.
I know.
That's Pixar?
No, it was
DreamWorks. Was it Fox?
Fox, whatever it was at that point.
Damn it. I don't know.
Tarzan.
Shut up.
I know, right? Yeah.
Phil Collins did the theme song for that, too.
Yeah.
I remember that.
Oh, yeah.
I remember he did
You'll
the theme song.
Be or that in my heart.
Yes. Wow, Tarzan.
Yeah. Not as good as 94 as The Lion King. So that stacks in 94's favor then. Okay.
94 is looking real good.
Real good. Yeah.
Real good.
Yeah. Yeah, what was, and then, no, there was nothing for Pixar in 99.
I'm not sure.
No, it was 98 was Bug's Life. I don't know, sorry, I'm going
on. Oh, and Ants was also that year,
Ants was
too.
98 as well. Yeah, that was the arms race. That's why they made Bug's Life, because of Ants. Yeah.
Who was it? No, Scorsese didn't direct it. Who was the director? There was a pretty high-end director. Oh.
Woody Allen was the main voice.
Yeah.
I don't know who directed it, though.
Steven Spielberg.
No.
I think it was Spielberg
Ants?
That did one of them.
Wow, we
got the technology. Let's look it up here. Ants.
Yeah.
I don't want the insect. Gross.
That movie in
1998.
Yeah.
Ants. Woody Allen was the
main
ant.
Yeah.
Directors Tim Johnson and Eric Darnell. So then it would have been a Bug's Life. Bug's Life movie. 1998.
Yeah.
And it was...
I don't know. Was it Pete Doctor? No, was it?
John Lasseter,
right.
Yeah, wow, what was I think that's
The Grand Poobah.
Yeah, because he did Toy Story.
Yes. And Cars.
And Cars. And Cars that's too. Why it was one of his blunders.
Yeah, I don't remember which one was good. He was being self-indulgent.
Was Ants or Bug's Life better?
Bug's Life
remember.
Was better.
Okay.
For me personally?
Vaguely remember.
But in the pantheon of Pixar, Bug's Life is always in the bottom. Because it was good at the time, but then you get... It doesn't hold up very well.
I hear you.
But that's what we should run a podcast on, because I have this weird Rain Man-esque when it comes to of dates and who produced.
You're like Scott Movie Mans.
Yeah. Is that who he's like that too?
He's very much like that.
He can just pick out dates
out of nowhere.
Really?
Yeah. I used to be good with like that with quotes, but in my older age, for some reason, I seem to be losing it.
Yeah.
It seems to be a muscle that I just abandoned.
Right.
And it comes in sporadically, like kind of like when Obi-Wan Kenobi hears his name, he's like, that's a name I haven't heard in quite some time. And then so I hear a quote, I'm like, I know that quote, but I haven't heard it in quite some time.
But isn't it funny though, because like you grow up and then you get married and you get a house. So that the quotes kind of move over because you have to learn how to fold the laundry right, the way that
which
self
I do it
likes
really
it,
well.
Right? So it's yeah, oh, do
yeah,
you?
Yeah. I'm gotten pretty good.
But that I will not. That's the one thing I will never lose. I always try to keep that sharpened because that brings me joy. So
yeah.
So sorry, how to do taxes? You're gone. Who won Best Picture in 1995? Boom. There we go. So,
and who was it?
Braveheart.
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 Freedom. Yeah. Well, do you got anything else in this Hollywood trends topic that you want to dive into?
No, I wish I could give you a little more, but
I don't know. I think we did. We are at an hour 44, so we did some shit.
We did some stuff. I don't know if it was coherent or it was. I know some of it wasn't.
Dude, most of my stuff isn't coherent. Literally, mine and Greg's was called A Map to Nowhere.
Oh,
we
okay.
It felt like we were riffing for 2.5 hours.
I love it.
Me and my buddy Matt Jordan also did the same thing. We talked about.
I know Matt Jordan.
Yeah, we did Fast and the Furious.
Oh, wow.
We called it the Fast and the Furious phenomenon.
Oh my God!
Yeah, it was a while ago.
If I'm allowed to come back, let's do like a deep dive on like a Fast and Furious. Let's do something.
Sure.
I don't know what it is.
Just pick something and just go into it.
Okay.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Next time, let's do that.
Before I let you go, I got some quick fire stuff.
Yeah.
Favorite superhero movie.
Oh Lord, really?
Sorry, I had to do it. Trend. Shit.
Spider-Man 2.
Favorite non-superhero movie?
Oh, God. Good Will Hunting.
Favorite TV show?
Dude, you're killing me. Breaking Bad.
My man.
Yeah.
Choice of movie snack?
Popcorn with Swedish berries mixed in.
You do the Flavor Blasters?
The Flavor Bastard.
Oh, you Flavor Bastard.
I'm a Flavored Bastard.
Who shot first?
Hans.
And lastly, what movie are you most excited to watch with your kids when they are old enough to see it?
Oh my God. Okay. It's going to be Pulp Fiction.
Oh, great.
It's gonna be Pulp
Good
Fiction.
Good man.
Yeah.
It's gonna Good be man. Fiction. That's called pandering to your audience.
That's right there. Well, this has been fun, man.
Dude, thank you so much for coming.
Yeah, thank you.
Did you have anything else you wanted to plug?
Concerns.
Anything at all? Do you still review? Because you were doing movie reviews.
No, we kind of abandoned that. And I miss doing that.
And now it's so just Leroy.
Yeah, Leroy and Leroy. I can't talk. It's been a full day. if you like country music and you have time to kill in your car from point A to B, tune in 2 to 6. Leroy to Leroy, we haven't filmed anything in the summertime because everyone's on holidays, but we'll be back in September, and I hope I'll be back soon because I kind of like it.
I hope you had fun with it.
It's a nice vibe.
Yeah, I hope so.
Yeah.
Last time I did in that, like I've got a better chair, but
I kind of like the open space up here. I haven't been in that room, so I don't, maybe I like it.
Yeah. It's better acoustically.
Ah.
Yeah.
Gotcha. For the deep dives, I understand.
Yeah. So,
what have we learned?
Again.
I don't know. Yeah. I don't.
What have we learned? Where is Hollywood going for? Mm-hmm. If you, do you have a Twitter handle? Do you have Instagram? Do you
yes.
have all that stuff? That
yeah,
plug?
Twitter at Brandon Hall F. Everything is at Brandon Hall FM,
mm-hmm.
which is my radio name, by the way. We didn't deep dive into that. It's actually Hall, not Flegel, because when I got a job in Moose Jaw, they didn't like my last name. They thought it was too.
They Hollywooded you.
They Hollywooded me, even though I was born in Moose Jaw. There's Flegels around.
Yeah.
They said just wasn't jiving, man. And they said, come back. This was a Friday. Come back on Monday with five names, last names, and we'll jive. I brought five names. None of them had Hall in it. I finished all my five and why I like these. And my boss, my soon-to-be boss, said, how about Hall? I'm like, do I have the fucking job? Yes, sir, Brandon Hall. And so it was Brandon Hall. And then when I moved to Regina, I wanted to go back to Flegel, but I had, in the country music radio world, I had Hall was... It was a name.
It was
I
a
guess.
Thing.
It was
now.
A name.
Was
so now is my yeah. So now
that's your
I'm,
superhero,
right? It's my superhero name.
You got Clark Kent, and you've got Kal-El.
Yeah.
You've
just
got
less,
Brandon
just
Flegel,
way nerdier.
Brandon Hall.
Way nerdier. So I had Brandon Hall FM. You can follow me in all forms. So,
nice.
Yeah.
Well, and you can also tell him about your Hollywood trends on all those forums. And you can also find me at Twitter at the F Words G. You can email us at thefwordpodcast@gmail.com. Make sure you're following the F Word Podcast on Instagram and on Facebook. And for everybody that's been listening, thank you once again for joining in on another deep dive. Whether you're listening to us on Anchor, Stitcher, Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, Breaker, CastBox, Overcast, Pocket Cast, Podbean, Radio Public, or YouTube. We appreciate it. And if you do have a chance to like or comment or leave stars or whatever the hell on any of those platforms, go for it. And if not, it's not a big deal. Yeah. Also want to thank the Saskatchewan Podcast Network for allowing us to be part of their network, and Kinexus for being a sponsor of said network. I'm G, and it's been myself and Brandon talking about Hollywood trends.
A pleasure.
And we are out.